Why don't you just start again?
Okay, I'm going to pull this back. I just wanted to comment on this notion of the fuzziness of human rights today, and I think partly I would cast it more broadly as the corporatization of human rights that we've been witnessing, where it's a good thing for corporations to say they're for human rights as part of their brand, but it doesn't really translate. The other thing that strikes me, and that is that since 9/11, I think that human rights, which was sort of the promise that was supposed to happen after the end of the Cold War, has not only diminished, it frankly has been totally put into question by the remaining superpower flouting every conceivable notion of human rights. And I think the whole regime of human rights is frankly very much put into question by what has happened in the last 13 years. So I think that we're in a very fragile position because the model that the United States has set in the last 13 years, I'm afraid, is going to have consequences. And I don't see any signs of that being overturned. So between a kind of fuzzy, we're all for human rights, and the actual realpolitik that's going on, really causing the demise of what was once the dream of human rights, I think we're in a very fragile position.
Yeah, I mean, it is true that the idea of there being a state of emergency in existence now for 13 years as an argument for the suspension of certain kinds of privacy rights, for example, the longer the state of exemption or emergency persists, the more disturbing this is. And it begins to look like, in all of our lifetimes, we will be in a permanent state of emergency. I mean, there's no way of imagining how there will be a kind of resolution. So I agree that that's disturbing. Part of the reason why it's, I think, has been so easy for a sort of center-left liberal like our president to relatively easily sort of transform into someone to the right of the Bush administration on drone attacks and on National Security Administration spying has something to do with the unclarity of the nature of the collective commitment to human rights. It is true that at the base, as Stephen was saying, at a sort of basic level, the freedom to pursue your own preferences without interference from others, assuming a like freedom from interference for those who pursue their preferences, that's a relatively basic kind of notion. It doesn't necessarily have anything to do with, say, listening to your phone conversations. That's a worry simply that because one never knows what the government will eventually do with that information, and it might in fact infringe your capacity to express yourself freely or something like that. So the worry is a worry of in potentia about what one might do with this information. But I do think that even at the level of this basic kind of negative freedom, of a capacity to pursue your preferences unimpeded by others on the assumption of a like capacity for all, there's still a lot of unclarity about the, let us say, whether the preferences you're pursuing are your own. This was not something that really worried Berlin, but we live in an age where the formation of the character of the citizens by mass culture, I would say there's been some sort of dramatic qualitative change, just in the number of hours our children spend on social media or in front of the computer. These are all kind of banal cliches by now. But it is disturbing that the whole social process of the formation of ethically competent subjects is now so much influenced by powerful forces of media that were unimaginable at the time of the writing of the Bill of Rights, and which we don't quite know how to impede. Remember, at the start of the internet, there was all this worry about children having access to pornography, and there were several laws that were drawn up. There were several barriers any user of the internet had to go through to get to. Where has all that gone? It's completely disappeared. You know, 8, 9, 10-year-old boys can have access immediately, if their parents aren't supervising them constantly, to the most grotesque pornography ever produced by human beings in half a second. I mean, this is a little bit of a digression from what you were asking about, but I do mean to say that even at the basic level, at which we're interested in the protection of the right of people to pursue their own sense of their own good, unimpeded by others, we still have this worry about what is forming powerfully their sense of their own good or their sense of the world. It doesn't seem to be, I mean, one would like to think it's still a kind of nuclear family structure that's doing so, but one can't have a concern about the right of people to pursue their own preferences and not have a concern about what is so influential and potentially damaging about the formation of their preferences. And one doesn't want the government involved in any way in regulating or supervising what we like to think as the pursuit of our own preferences, but that runs up against this other worry. So I do think there's a great deal of fuzziness that's quite complicated.
I mean, I share the concern that the legal impediments to government surveillance and to the targeting of individual citizens should be a matter of concern. Although I do consider it kind of a luxury that we can be obsessed with hypothetical possibilities, given that if you were to survey the state of human rights, freedom of expression worldwide, the changes in, since 9/11 in the United States, I think, are quite trivial compared to the situation of human rights in much of the rest of the world. Despite some of these changes, which I agree are deplorable and should be, we should push back against them. As far as I know, no one has been thrown in jail in the United States for political opposition to either the Bush or the Obama administration. Something that you cannot say about many other parts of the world, Russia maybe being the one that's been in the news most recently, where opposition politicians and journalists and academics are routinely thrown into jail for all kinds of trumped up charges of corruption. Malaysia, the opposition leader, has just been sentenced for sodomy. So if we're concerned about worldwide human rights, it seems to me that the events in 9/11 in the U.S. are kind of low on the list of priorities, though I agree deserving of some attention. In terms of the what the younger people are doing, I'm always wary of arguments that say the kids are going to hell. Just because I remember my parents' generation saying that about us, we spent too much time on the telephone talking to other teenagers, we had transistor radios up against our ears, we watched too much television. And as a member of the same generation, I do look at my students constantly on Facebook, and since I'm not constantly on Facebook, I tend to think this isn't a good thing. But I also think we should put into perspective any of this intergenerational criticism, that it's probably a constant of human existence, that one generation always worries about the values of the next one, and we should try to discount our own generational disdain accordingly.
Let me just build on that one, the original question, and pose it in this form. Is it the case that there is a lexical paradise such that the right for security of our lives, which you point to so powerfully in your book, in many instances leads us to trump other rights that we take seriously? I mean, is that an inevitable consequence of our desire for self-preservation and elimination of violence?
Well, it kind of has to be, in the sense that the post 9/11, there was a great concern about privacy and freedom from surveillance, and at the same time there was this barrage of criticism of the government for not connecting the dots, not anticipating it. How come they didn't protect us? Why didn't now? We can't have all of both, and I suspect that any defensible arrangement is going to have to trade off these values. I think there is a good argument that with the Bush administration continuing into the Obama administration, we've tilted it a bit too far in letting the government peer into our records. On the other hand, we really don't want there to be a nuclear terrorist attack, and for all kinds of reasons, you do want the government to have some power to be able to detect and disrupt these events before they happen. So I don't think there's a black and white answer as to should government have rights of surveillance or not. It's a question of titrating security against freedom.
So we have a question first back there. And then
yes, I'll preface my remarks by saying I spent the entire decade of the 60s in college, so I was a transistor radio slash a hippie type. But violence, organized violence, I contend that goes back to feudalism. And as we progressed into nation states fearing each other formed alliances. The double entente, the triple entente. Somebody shoots the Duke of Austria, the next thing you know, Woodrow Wilson is sending troops to Europe. At the end of the First World War, Hitler is born because of the revenge of the countries against Germany. And in the Middle East, our current problem was created when the artificial nations were put in place. The Iranians remember the overthrow of a democratically elected government. The Afghans have been fighting to kick foreigners out of their country for over 1,000 years. Crimea, they even named a war after Crimea. Russia's paranoid, and the people who live in Crimea in the minority are the Tatars. And they were the scourge of Russia at a certain point in history, as were the Mongols, who are now identified with the Chinese. We remember the Cold War. Three people ran the world: China, Russia, and the United States. Now we're getting weaker, the Chinese are getting stronger, the Russians are trying to figure out what they want to do, and we're all divided up. The Kurds, half their country's in Turkey. So every time somebody talks about the Kurds having their own government, the Turks get upset because of what they've done. So I say that the organization of violence and the division of people into artificial barriers may be one of the main things that's causing all of this problem. If I belong to a tribe in what is now called Iraq, I don't want those other tribes telling me what to do. I have my rights. Religion, you use the word fundamentalism. The fundamentalists of all religions cause more of the trouble than anybody else. So what is the basis of a solution to this problem we've spent 250, 300 years creating?
I think it is a profound question, and it's I think one that we're still groping toward an answer. And when we ask is there any content to the notion of human rights, the topic of this conference, or is it just, as I said last night, Mother Pie and Applehood? There is content, and I think we can clarify it when we realize what stands in opposition. What's unhuman rights? What's the opposite of human rights? And I think we have to realize that the notion of nation state sovereignty, self-determination of ethnic groups, is really not the same as the concept of human rights. And I think you correctly note that a political organization in which government force is aligned with the interests of some religion or ethnic group, which has kind of been the basis of the world order, probably starting in the 19th century, accelerated after World War I, is something that needs to be systematically rethought. Because a world in which there are going to be borders that encircle homogeneous nations in the sense of ethnicities and languages and religions is would call for infinite ethnic cleansing. Members of different groups move around, they tend to interdigitate, they mingle. This is a very good thing. The idea that the guys with the guns are going to protect the interests of one particular ethnicity is just a bad idea. And you've listed a number of cases showing why it's a bad idea. So the idea that a state or a government, meaning the elite with a monopoly on the use of violence, should be more oriented around some kind of social contract embracing everyone that happens to share a patch of territory, and that there is that governments are conveniences to implement the idea that people should not prey upon one another, but have no intrinsic value. That is, it's not intrinsically a good thing to give up your life for the glory of your country. But rather, the ultimate value is simply the men, women, and children who happen to be situated within a country, and that the only purpose of government is to enhance their flourishing. We're not really there at that point. I mean, I consider that to be the promise of the concept of human rights, but if we're serious about human rights, we have to swallow hard and realize what human rights are not. And one of the things that I think human rights are not are sovereignty, nationalism, self-determination of ethnic groups. There is that tension, and we're going to have to deal with it.
Here and then in the back.
Can I stand up?
Yeah, please come stand to the mic.
Last night, we heard that there was a counterintuitive element to Dr. Pinker's argument and that really struck me as possibly correct until I again heard the data, which is very compelling. And it suggests that this is not counterintuitive, it's just a description of something that has gone on, maybe during the Enlightenment and actually going back further than that, but particularly in the last few hundred years. But I wanted to raise a couple of questions about this. One is, we can get a little smug realizing how unaggressive we all are now, but is it really the right way of understanding things? We saw how violence got apparently diminished over the last few hundred years during this great Enlightenment expansion in modernity. But during that same time, We got species collapse going on with the global warming. We got huge population expansion, and the increases that are predicted are staggering beyond comprehension. And nuclearism, of course, which is very much linked to the Enlightenment, physics, and so forth. So we got three very dangerous trends that were stirred up by the same infrastructure of history that the Enlightenment was. The Enlightenment made direct contributions to some of these dangerous three things. So, you know, maybe we've gotten away from killing the guy across the street, but have we escaped planet murder? Because that's what we're about right now.
Is it planet murder?
Planet
murder.
Sorry.
Yeah. Well, I think we're better at doing everything, including exterminating other species. Although that has been going on for as long as there have been humans. The archaeological record suggests that whenever humans first moved into a territory, the indigenous species dropped like flies, and there were probably mass extinctions, for example, of megafauna in the Americas with the arrival of Homo sapiens. So I don't think this is a new thing, although we are getting better and better at doing it. The question is, there are two questions concerning the what we're doing to the planet as it relates to the greater topic of violence and human rights. One of them is whether the effect that we're going to have on the planet is necessarily going to decrease human welfare in the aggregate. That's a separate set of issues as to whether there's something intrinsically immoral about changing the ecosystem. So the way that I think the question should be framed is, are we heading toward a situation in which many people will starve or die of disease and otherwise suffer a decrease in flourishing? So far, the trend is that human flourishing is increasing. People are living longer, they're less likely to die of disease, they're more likely to survive the first year of life. So part of what we're doing to the planet is for the benefit, so far at least, has been for the benefit of men, women, and children. Whether that will reach some catastrophic reversal with climate change is really the way that we have to pose the question. The other is whether changes in ecological circumstances are going to lead to violence itself, whether there's going to be war as a result of shortages of resources or land. And there, as I mentioned last night, I'm skeptical. I think that we do have to be very concerned about the possibility of starvation and population movements and human misery as a result of climate change. But the idea that it will necessarily lead to war is something that is much less certain. Most wars are not fought over resources. Most resource shortages don't lead to wars. So we're going to have enough on our hands in dealing with climate change in terms of its human impact, that the hypothetical worry that will also lead to an increase with wars, I don't think is it should be at the top of the list.
In the back.
Thank you. I'm Nora Fisher-Olnar, a fellow at the center. And I wanted to thank Professor Pinker for his very powerful talk and perspective. Also suggestive are some of the things that you partially say and that you leave unsaid. And among these are the quite robust empirical trend on a scale of the late 20th or late 21st century of religious resurgence. And in there's a corresponding amount of scholarly research on this about basically the renaissance of religion, as it were, in the Islamic world and the Hindu world and the Southeast Asian Buddhist world, and of course new religious movements in the Christian West, notably the United States. And any rough estimate, even if one were to assume that within these societies and communities there are a good number of agnostics and secularists and atheists, but any rough estimates, if we're to take them as a monolithic category, this is about 2 to 3 billion people. And these people seem to be in some way embedded in a pathway to modernity that does not necessarily graft onto secular enlightenment individualism, which is the tradition in which you very much ground your understanding of human rights. So my question is kind of a little bit provocative on the basis of an answer you gave to an earlier question. We've heard some biogeneticist language used here yesterday and today. Do you expect this to be a regressive trend that is just going to be assimilated into the genealogy that you advocate, the secular enlightenment pathway to human rights? Are these people going to be outbirthed by fertile French women, as you put it? Do you give any credence to the possibility of alternative trajectories to human rights that don't emanate from a secular, liberal, individualistic perspective, and yet that are part and parcel of alternative trajectories to modernity?
Yeah. I think I don't think there is a global trend toward a greater religious fundamentalism, although there are, as you know, large swaths of the world in which that is happening. Because there are many currents, one of them being a continuation of the secularization that it's easy to lose sight of, and that happens by stealth in two ways. One of them is that we tend to essentialize other countries, especially in the Islamic world, and think that that a country like Iran is populated by tens of millions of mullahs and ayatollahs. But the public opinion polls show that in every Islamic country, there is an enormous pent-up sympathy toward liberal democratic values. Sometimes it's not a majority, it might be 40%. Sometimes it is a majority, but they are just squelched by either the theocrats or the petrocrats. It often is itself not identical to Western homogeneous notions of individual rights, but there is a certain amount of compartmentalization where people on the one hand will say that they believe that Sharia law should be imposed, but they have a rather fuzzy idea as to what Sharia law actually consists of, and they'll also maintain that the clerics should not have political power and that women should get equal rights. So they have a patchwork of not completely consistent beliefs, many of which really are quite liberal and secularly justified. So it's a complicated situation even in the Islamic world, and despite our tendency to think that they're all theocrats. Likewise, in the United States and other countries, such as in Latin America, where there is an apparent resurgence of religion, there too, fortunately, there is a lot of benevolent hypocrisy. So you don't, if you really believe that the only path to salvation, to being rescued from an eternity in hell, is to embrace Jesus Christ as your savior, you really should be trying to convert everyone else at sword point for their own good. And you really should be burning heretics who are spreading the bad example of luring people away from salvation. But even the most fundamentalist Christians in the United States aren't doing that anymore. I mean, that's what Christianity did a couple of hundred years ago. So they're willing to tolerate a certain amount of hypocrisy in their own belief system, and while professing to believe in the inerrancy of the Bible and all of that, their actual belief systems and their political agenda are, by historical standards, extremely liberal and tolerant. We're seeing that happen this very year with the sea change that we're witnessing regarding gay marriage, where it looks like, I think it's very likely that within a decade, gay marriage will be the norm in most of the United States, and people will have forgotten the controversy, even though all of the people who are going to live with gay marriage are still going to call themselves Christian. So one of the effects of, I think, the spread of Enlightenment humanist values is that religions themselves change as a result. Either explicitly when there's a switch in doctrine, as we see happened with the ecumenical council in the Vatican in the early 1960s, or the decisions of the Mormon Church to rethink revelation or to conveniently have new revelations that allow that such that blacks should no longer bear the mark of Cain, or even prior to that, that polygamy was not, after all, a central tenet of the Mormon Church, or more subtly along the lines that people believe one thing but act in accordance with, or say they believe one thing but act in accordance with much more liberal values. So those are the complexities that suggest that it's, despite the apparent resurgence of fundamentalism worldwide, the situation is more nuanced, and that Enlightenment liberal values have more power than we might give them credit for.
No.
I have a sort of small ball question for Professor Pinker, and then a question for both panelists, or maybe all panelists. The small question is about method, which is that about method.
Method.
And I just, in listening, and I apologize if you answered this question last night, I had to leave in the middle of the Q&A, but in thinking about your data sets, I'm a historian of Latin America, and what struck me is that what you took as kind of established facts, or what you presented here as this is how you've assessed them, in my world are highly contested numbers, and so I was curious to know how you decided upon credibility of the data that you were using, particularly in these different periods when method would have been radically different in terms of collecting that data. So you kind of glossed it yesterday, but when I think about the historiography of the Mexican Revolution, like entire careers have been spent determining how many people died during the Mexican Revolution and its aftermath, right? So sort of what you, in dealing with this vast literature, sort of how you decided.
Yeah.
And the bigger question for both of you, which takes a little bit off of Professor Pippin's I think gesture towards psychological violence. We keep coming back to the question of war, which is of course a pretty small segment of overall violence. And we've mentioned environmental violence briefly yesterday. Mentioned domestic violence, animal violence. So I'm wondering what happens when we broaden the conversation beyond war and maybe disaggregate by these segments. And in particular, what it means that we're in an era now of this. Really, the technologies and scale of violence are so particular. In other words, we're in the post-World War II period is maybe an exception rather than part of a trend in that, Professor Pippin mentioned sort of mutually assured destruction and the technologies of violence in terms of nuclear warfare, but also that you can sit in a computer in Oregon or whatever and be bombing someplace in Afghanistan and what it means. Maybe this takes you back to your home discipline of psychology and certainly to ethics, but to be able to have such a sanitized violence and violence of large scales in this broad sweep of history we're thinking about. And I guess in particular to think of this in the terms of the conference theme about what this means for humanity and human rights.
Yeah. Okay, let me go through them in order. In terms of methods, the answer is different for the different data sets. And of course, the question is always relevant. When it comes to the distant past, then yes, there is, every one of the figures has been contested. So my rule was to choose data sets that had been compiled by others using a consistent set of criteria so that I did not have the freedom to cherry pick, say, high estimates from the more recent past and low estimates, from the more distant past and low estimates for the more recent past. For the really big data sets going back to 2,500 years, one of the reasons that I went with Matthew White was not just because he was one of the few people to try to put numbers of any kind on them, but he, for each one of these incidents, scoured the literature, laid out every quantitative estimate that anyone had ever bruited, and then tried to pick a defensible value from that range, usually something close to the middle, to the geometric mean, where the outliers would not have too big an effect on the estimate. But admittedly, even though I think that was the best practice, which is why I reproduced those numbers, there absolutely is an enormous amount of uncertainty, especially in the distant past. The best records that we have when it comes to war are from the post-World War II period, simply because a couple of organizations, such as the Peace Research Institute of Oslo, have done their best to assemble the most reliable data sets they can year by year, every year since 1946, and the Uppsala Conflict Data Project, trying to use a constant yardstick so that the point is not whether the estimates are objectively correct, something that we may never know, but rather whether any kind of overestimate or underestimate would be consistent year by year so that you could say something meaningful about the trends. In other cases, the data set that I used would depend on the particular category of violence. For something like rape, for example, or other kinds of non-lethal crime that don't leave a convenient corpse, one has to worry about changes in the likelihood of reporting a crime to the police. So I think that police statistics are pretty useless. And so I relied on victimization surveys where people are asked, did any of the following crimes happen to you in a way that was consistent from year to year? And so the answer is different for each category of violence, where I had to make a separate decision as to what was the most defensible and least biased method in each case. When it comes to categories of violence, I consider sentience to be a critical boundary. That is, I think there is, if you harm a person, if you kill them, injure them, coerce them, rape them, and so on, then that is clearly violence. If you torture or kill an animal because an animal is salient, I count that as a kind of violence. If you cut down a tree, that might be deplorable for all kinds of reasons, but I'm willing to draw a line on the best scientific understanding that trees don't feel pain, they don't have interests as such. I think it's wise to just keep that as a separate category, and so that's why I don't think that it makes much sense to consider to have a category of environmental violence. A mountaintop can't feel pain, a rock can't feel pain, a tree can't feel pain. And so while these are legitimate targets of our concern, it's not the same thing as raping or killing a person. I don't think that for all the attention that drones and remote control warfare have received, I actually don't think that this is a particularly deplorable development. On the contrary, I think it's although I don't think any kind of war is a good idea, I don't think that drones have made things worse. I think they've made them better. They make things better because you have less, as the euphemism goes, collateral damage. That if you compare the use of drones to conventional tactics of warfare, such as aerial bombardment, such as search and destroy missions, such as artillery barrages, they're just incomparable. Drones are incomparably more humane if you're waging a war in the first place, which, you know, in general, one should not, but I don't think drones are really the problem. And this is reflected in the numbers. The number of people altogether and the number of civilians killed in Afghanistan and Pakistan are just tiny fractions compared to, say, the Russian campaign in Afghanistan, the Americans in Vietnam, and earlier periods of warfare. As to whether remote control warfare would somehow make it easier, less traumatic, lower a psychological barrier, I think the answer is no. I mean, we just heard that how in the, for example, in the Indonesian Year of Living Dangerously, in which there was a massive genocide of supposed communists, a lot of them were killed with piano wire. And history tells us that people can very easily overcome their compunctions about face-to-face, hand-to-hand killing. And conversely, it turns out that studies of remote-controlled drone operators show that they're plenty traumatized by what they're doing, because they're following that guy around day after day after day, seeing him play with his kids and go to the bathroom and walk across, and then they've got to kill him. That is actually deeply upsetting, and we should be glad that it is upsetting, but I don't think we're in an age in which compunctions against killing have been neutralized. Quite the contrary, history shows that we have no problem with killing with our bare hands.
Well, on the category of violence, I think there is a disagreement here. I do think there are categories like the deliberate infliction of suffering that don't necessarily, I mean, I have no particular stake in the word violence. So if you want to consider this as a sort of separate category, that's fine. But something like, for example, I think all of us would agree that the psychological abuse of children by their parents is either a form of violence or some sort of infliction of suffering that is objectionable. I don't think many people would disagree with that. If they don't hit their children, they don't put them in the closet, they don't starve them. But there are forms of psychological violence against children that I think we should count as violence. But if that is true, and if it's true that solitary confinement, because coerced, and primarily because coerced, is a form of violence, then what should we say about, say, labor conditions in context where the people at issue, the workers in a Pakistani garment factory, really have no other option if they want to survive but to work under conditions that inflict an enormous amount of both psychological and physical suffering and are at great risk for the sake of the profit of others. So I do think there is still, perhaps we disagree about this, one other disagreement I'll mention in a moment, but I do think it's important not to categorize that away. I mean, I don't have any particular view on whether it's increasing or decreasing or anything like that, but there's an awful lot of it, and we ought to be bothered by it. And when you consider the conditions of global trade and the incentives people have for creating labor conditions that are oppressive and unjust because they inflict suffering for the profit of others, that seems to me a real concern and a violation of human rights that we ought to worry about. I think the more general issue I have with the category of human rights, the way Stephen discusses it, is this: the idea that the basic concept has to do with our being better off if we authorize the state to arrest and punish violent offenders or people who wish to interfere with the exercise of our freedom is essentially a kind of libertarian notion of the foundation of political order. I'm not even sure, since people like Mill and Bentham were contemptuous of the idea of human rights, I'm not even sure that's the right way to think of it. The original idea, I mean, of course, the original idea has to do essentially with religion, and our founding documents make clear that the original justification for the claim of human rights has to do with what is granted by the Creator and so forth, and the inviolable dignity of the human subject. But that's been secularized, that's been a good thing. But there is a kind of moral claim to the status of human rights, that is, treatment with dignity and respect as a free, rational individual, that has implications that go beyond just the protection of people from harm by offenders, as in the traditional libertarian argument. And if that is true, then there are issues of concern to us that go beyond just the protection of people from harm, that the conditions under which they can't live their lives as free and rational subjects with a certain sort of dignity ought to be a concern to us as well. And the inhibition of that is a wrong, and it has many different forms that we ought to be concerned with. So I'm not exactly sure what the ultimate philosophical account of human rights is that's behind your account, but it sounded like it was this vaguely libertarian notion of our negotiating a way of being better off with each other. I think that's actually inimical to the human rights tradition, as its original founders made clear, and that once one's on the side of the secularized version of the entitlement claim as a moral claim, there are various other issues that are implied that can't be restricted to just keeping people free from harm, however important that is.
Yeah. Well, I think I agree that's a profound observation, and I do think that it calls on us to think clearly about what we mean by human rights, that very often the notion of human rights, and particularly its companion notion of human dignity, really needs to be rethought. We can't just take it for granted that we know what human dignity is or human rights are without articulating them further. And indeed, there will be conflicts between, as you put it, a more libertarian conception of human rights and ones that are based on dignity. For example, should people have the right to donate organs and be compensated for them, where everyone is better off, no one is worse off? But some would say that, some people say that the government should coerce people not to do that because it impinges on a notion of human dignity. Or stem cell research, that's another a concrete example that came up during the Bush administration, where the arguments for somatic cell nuclear transfer, so-called therapeutic cloning, were that they could make a lot of people much better off and didn't make anyone worse off, but the President's Council on Bioethics convinced Bush to criminalize certain categories of research, again, because it impinged on human dignity, whatever that is. I actually think it is, so I guess my own sympathies are closer to the Mill Bentham libertarian line, that we should not invoke, pull human rights out of the sky as if it was clear what they were. I think I would go beyond them and say that human rights are often a very practical way to enhance human flourishing, simply because there are some cases in which drawing red lines is a very good way to prevent nibbling away at human freedom and well-being. But we can't take them for granted. And I agree that the origin from a kind of natural rights given by our creator that is subsequently secularized leaves open profound questions as to what they are if they're something other than maximizing human well-being.
Jeff?
Stephen, your argument is that violence has declined, but not that we have become less violent. At least I take that to be your argument. And you do deny that that it's possible for human nature to have changed in the wink of an eye since violence began to decline statistically. So I'd like you to contemplate a somewhat more speculative question, that if violence of a measurable statistical kind has declined, that it is compensated for by an increase in violence in some other area. And in this case, the obvious candidate would be the area of our imaginations. And it's apparent to me that we have become so inundated with extreme images of violence from all directions that it's possible that while statistical violence has declined, we have become actually more violent at the imaginative level. What do you think the connection might be between the images of violence that occupy our minds and the actual acts of violence that can be measured?
Yeah, and I think you correctly characterized my position. I don't think psychologically, by and large, we've become less violent. I think in some ways we have. But the question then is there a kind of fixed amount of violent psychic energy that has to be, if it is blocked from certain channels of expression, will it be diverted to others? And I suspect not. I think that there are, and I think it's a common conception, that if we have any tendency toward violence at all, it's a kind of homeostatic or hydraulic urge. And this is a notion that we've inherited from Freud and from many 19th century models of the mind as operating on a hydraulic principle, that pressure builds up and it has to be released. Because that feels intuitively right for certain kinds of human urges, such as hunger and thirst, the need for sleep, sexuality. It needs release, and if it doesn't get it, it will be sublimated or diverted to some other channel. I don't think violence works that way. I think that it is more, to use some jargon, more facultative than homeostatic, which is to say, triggered by certain circumstances. There are, I think, innate human motives which I suspect are wired into us, that had an adaptive function, but that are only expressed in under certain environmental circumstances. Just to give a very concrete example, shivering. I mean, the reflex to shiver is clearly something that is built into us, but you could go your entire life without ever shivering again if you were never cold. Sexual jealousy is another one. I think we're all liable to have get very upset at the thought of our romantic partner having sex with or flirting with a rival. But if that never happens, that that entire complex could just never be experienced. So likewise, I think that many categories of violence don't necessarily need some alternative output channel if the circumstances that ordinarily trigger them, like mortal fear of being attacked or finding oneself in a zero-sum contest for dominance, we never find themselves in those conditions. So in that way, I'm a bit more hopeful. Also, my reading of the history, the cultural history of violent entertainment, is that it's not so clear that there has been a recent increase. That if you look at Homer, if you look at the Old Testament, if you look at the lives of the saints, the deaths of the saints, I should say, each of which was tortured to death in gruesome, often sexually colored ways. I mean, just look at how, you know, you look at St. George and St. Catherine and all the names that you recognize as the names of streets and cities in Catholic countries. They were all gruesomely tortured to death, and people consumed these hagiographies and must have taken some relish in these stories, which we have reason to believe are completely apocryphal as to how the early Christian martyrs met their ends. If you look at Shakespeare's tragedies, popular forms of entertainment, grand guignol, dime novels, pulp fiction, penny dreadfuls, Grimm's fairy tales, Punch and Judy, there's a long history of really grisly, kind of splatter-filled popular entertainment. It's a wonderful book called Savage Pastimes by, I think his name is Harold Sheckman, professor of English at Queen's College, where he disputes the idea that entertainment has gotten more violent recently.
Let me ask one sort of final question to pull this together, which relates violence to human rights. Even if it were true, which I believe it is, that violence has declined, would we imagine that we were better off for human rights if violence had only also become more effective? So that Stalin, for example, had to arrest millions in order to attain his ends. What if through surveillance we know that we don't need to arrest millions, we only need to arrest those people who are opposed to our way of life, or to go back to the drone example, to kill those people who are the leaders in a kind of anti-liberal view of the world? Would we feel confident that a reduction in violence was also better for human rights, meant that we were better at securing human rights, or would that maybe even alert us to the fact that there are more dangers to be concerned with?
Yeah. Clearly it would be better. That is, if three people were killed instead of 30 million people, yeah, that's absolutely better. But also, I think there's a real false equivalence that we are so properly vigilant over abuses by our government that we make comparisons that are just completely disproportionate. So whether or not the targeted killings are justifiable, and I think they probably are not, it's not the same as what Stalin tried to do. That is, it's not as if by going after the Taliban in Pakistan, we are doing exactly what Stalin tried to do, only we're doing it with fewer deaths. Now, even if that were the case, fewer deaths is greater than more deaths, but I don't think that going after the Taliban is the same as what Stalin did with his political opponents, with the Ukrainians, with the Jews, and so on. I think we've got to keep a sense of proportion here. Even as we properly criticize the abuses of our own government, let's keep perspective.
I agree with that. But I do think there's an alternate form of argument, not the sort of moral equivalence argument we used to hear all the time, in the 60s. But also, I think there's a danger in arguing, for example, as in the question of surveillance and privacy rights, things are so much worse elsewhere. We really shouldn't worry so much about what we're going through. I think that's a slippery slope and somewhat dangerous. It is quite disturbing that the government can listen to and does listen to all our phone calls. I mean, but just because of the potential abuse by the people, after all, run the government are not machines. They're frail, often neurotic, unreliable, and politically motivated creatures. And I don't want them in charge of what happens to my phone data. I think there's also a kind of slippery slope in one generation always complains about the younger generation. That's an alternate form of what I earlier called barroom conversation or cafe society conversation. It, to some extent, it's true. But I would say that the power of modern consumerism is absolutely unprecedented. And we have no idea what the ultimate effects on the generally held culture will be. And it transcends the normal griping by an older generation about a younger generation. I don't know how we prove that or how we settle that, but one can only evince one's worries. And I think it is a bit worrisome to say, oh, we always do this. Things are a lot different now than they were even when I was 18 years old.
I want to thank all of you, and I want to thank our panelists.